Kigoma is a city and lakeport in Tanzania, on the northeastern shores of Lake Tanganyika and close to the border with Burundi. The Jakesson Beach, which where I started some activities, is a pleasant place for the residents of Kigoma to spend their days off. In 1920, Reagan described the genus Schiaptopharynx and designated three species within the genus. To be mentioned, Schiaptopharynx fruciferus, which has been described by Boulenger in 1898, that time as Paratilapia fruciferus. Schiaptopharynx foae has been described a year later, in 1899, by Valent as Ectodus foae. And in the same year, 1899, Boulenger described Tilapia grandoculus from a single specimen. In the meantime, Schiaptopharynx grandoculus has been synonymous with Schiaptopharynx foae. These small beaches are situated between serious rock formations. Just around the corner of this protruding rock formation runs a rocky coastline that slopes down to depths of around 40 meters and is therefore a beautiful location for diving. The upper wave-washed rocky habitat harbors several specialized cichlids, which graze from the rich algae covers on the rocks. One of those specialized cichlids is the Gobi cichlid Eretmodus marksmithii. Interesting of this species is the large number of spines in the dorsal fin, which has evolved to defend against attacks of birds and stay hopping during feeding in very shallow water. The juvenile Trovius dubosi has also its optimal habitat here in its first phase of life, where it finds an abundance of algae and also protection between the crevices of the rock formation. But many cichlid species are coming together here, from which the species out of the genus Petrochromus maintain a very dominant role in the upper layer of the rocky habitat. Many mouth-brooding cichlids deposit their offspring in the shallows of the rocky habitat, sometimes forming large shoals. Where the slope started to take serious shapes, I descended a little to a greater depth, where Petrochromus was also conspicuously present. But also Trophius brichardi, whose males constantly court females in an attempt to pass on their genus in their offspring. A little deeper along the slope, a cichlid passed me with five dark vertical stripes and can therefore be distinguished as Neolamprologus tetroceps valens. This species is characterized by the very strong teeth in the back of the mouth, which are used to crack snail shells. Breeding this cave breeder in the aquarium is particularly difficult, more about forming a good couple, because This species is monogamous and will stay with its partner for a long time. Wild caught imported specimens that are separated from their partner can show very aggressive behavior towards females in the aquarium. Males can grow to about 15 centimeters, while females remain slightly smaller. While swimming over the rock formation, I noticed that there was a relatively low fish population compared to other places in the lake where I have dived before. I think that there are a lot of fishing activities going on here. Several species that have their habitat here are popular in the aquarium. Haplotaxodon and Microlepis has a lake-wide distribution. It occurs in the upper 10 meters of the water column over intermediate habitats, hunting for juvenile species of other fish. Some non-cichlid species show up, such as the spiny eel out of the genus Mastassemblus, as well a beautiful Cynodonta species that show up later on top of the rock. Cynodontus lucipinus, a beautiful species. Within the background, under some overhanging sides of boulders, a pair of Neolamprologus fruciver occurs in the dark recesses of the rocky habitat. Also bound to the rocky substrate are Paracyprigromus brieni. More deeply, along the slope, a few Cheoptilapia frontosa adults swim away in my presence. In the meantime, I had already swum over several abandoned sandcastles, where the residents probably may have been captured. Throughout the lake, and especially in this area, there are a lot of fishing activities going on for the ornamental fish trade. In a slightly deeper layer, I noticed that the rock formation had a white deposit that looked to me like a kind of lime. But there are still some beautiful stretches where some beautiful fish swims around, such as this large plankton feeding group Neolamprologus pulcher. When I swam along a steep slope, I had the feeling that there was an upward current. This upward current pushes up large amounts of plankton from the deeper parts of the lake, and that in turn attracts large shoals of plankton eaters, such as Cyprichromus species Leptosoma gigoma. Some rock-dwelling dwarfs, Thelmatochromus bifrenatus, forage on top of the rocks in search of food. In general is Ophthalmotilapia ventralis found in the surge habitat, feeding on phytoplankton. While swimming, beautiful underwater sceneries loomed up in front of me. Join me for some wonderful moments as I ventured through the intermediate habitat. Thank you.
At one stretch, several bowers with Siamtam pharynx appeared in front of my camera. But this was a rather shy specimen that swims away from me immediately. It is known that Siamtam pharynx often occurs in breeding colonies. Here too, another male has built his bower within a distance of 10 meters. In a slightly deeper area, I saw a dark-colored featherfin working on his bower, which I initially thought it was Siamtam pharynx fly. But after I got a little closer to the fish, it turned out not to be a fly, but a relatively rare species that occurs in the northeastern part of the lake. This is Ophthalmotilapia, a species Paranasuta, who is sometimes confused with Ophthalmotilapia nasuta. Ophthalmotilapia species Paranasuta builds their bowers along big boulders, in contrast to Ophthalmotilapia nasuta that built its bowers on top of large boulders. Furthermore, there is a clear difference in the morphology of the nose of both species. Ophthalmotilapia nasuta that has a significantly larger nose, probably to be more attractive to the females. In the meantime, the first Siamtam pharynx showed up, an adult male, but not a territorial male, as he did not maintain a sandcastle. Males who are territorial build sandcastles on flat rocks or on the sand. Usually, several territorial males can be found in breeding colonies. Not territorial males hang around in the vicinities of such breeding colonies, just waiting for a bower to become vacant. Non-territorial males also swim around sometimes in small groups. In my previous video with the title Habitat of Trophaeus dubosi, which I recorded as well in Kigoma, I mentioned that in my following video I would show a little more of Siamtam pharynx fruciferae, a species that has endured a rather confusing description and with which I must therefore proceed with caution when identifying this cichlid. Siamtam pharynx fruciferae has been described from the south of the lake, probably out of two small specimens collected along the Olungu escarpment in Zambia. So, could this be a Siamtam pharynx fruciferae? In the past, I have posted some pictures of this cichlid together with a Siamtam pharynx foae from Conway Island in the media. And at that time, this cichlid was identified by some well-known Lake Tanganyika cichlid experts as Siamtam pharynx species fruciferae Noord. I would therefore like to follow this identification. Along the slope, I saw a beautiful territorial male, Siamtam pharynx species fruciferae Noord, maintaining a nice big sandcastle on a large boulder, around a depth of 10 meters. I found Siamtam pharynx at depths between 10 and 20 meters, and always near sand. This fish is called the king of the featherfins and is the most striking cichlid of Lake Tanganyika. The iridescent colors of territorial males and the building of large sandcastles make them very popular among the aquarists. This male was not shy and just continued with his activities, a wonderful specimen to study for a while. As I got a little closer, I estimated the bower to be about 60 centimeters in diameter. A study has proven that the size of the bower, the diameter of the inner mating crater, is an individual characteristic choice. During the study, They reduced or enlarged the size of several craters, and in all instances, the resident males restored the size of the crater within hours to its original diameter. They also found that it takes about 3 days for a male to completely rebuild his bower from the ground up, following its destruction by a storm. And in such cases too, the male rebuilt his crater in the same size as before. Males of Schiantopharynx can attain a length of about 22 cm, but adult females are normally around 12 to 15 cm. During the next images, you can see that Schiantopharynx has quite an almost continuous flow of waste. Schiantopharynx feed on the algae and diatoms, which are present in the biocover on rocks as well in the sediment from the substrate. They have to consume copious amounts. Therefore, the poor nutritional value of the material ingested causes an almost continuous and noticeably flow of waste. The intestines are about 3 times as long as the fish itself and contain large amounts of fine sand and digestible material. I think that is also a reason why they sometimes swim a little rocking when they have a full stomach. The swim bladder cannot then compensate for the excess weight of the ingested sand. The netness of a bower and the activity of the male appears to be a positive signal to the female when she is looking for a mate. Therefore, the males use a lot of time to maintain the bower in optimum conditions. A non-territorial male without a bower does not have any chance by the females. Females are attracted only to actively courting males. Males court interesting females with a quivering display and with all fins erect. And when a male finds a willing female, he leads her to the center of his bower and shows her where to lay her eggs by dragging his ventral fins over the spawning site. The male has beautiful long ventral fins with on the end some bright yellow tips, which he used to indicate to the females where she has to deposit her eggs. Perhaps the long ventral fins guide the males towards the eggs as the pectoral fins push a stream of water downwards. A female that follows a male in his bower does not always start laying eggs. Less than 10% of females that followed a male in his bower also laid eggs there. Here we see a female passing by with a mouthful of eggs or larvae, and it looks that therefore the male doesn't show any interest in her. Those of you who are observant have noticed that Neolamprologus mondabu has laid eggs on the vertical wall of the rock formation in Schiantopharynx territory. Perhaps a smart move, as they also find protection here through the territorial behavior of Schiantopharynx, which tolerates the presence of this breeding pair. Well, I have not used the name Frucifer continuously because I am still not convinced about the correct identification of this cichlid. In several books and articles on the web, there are still ongoing discussions regarding the northern variant of Schiantopharynx Frucifer, as long as it has not been officially described. Ad Konings does mention it in his book that it is interesting that these Schiantopharynx have a golden patch on their head, which could have a relationship with the golden-headed zeevuursever from the southern part of the lake. Furthermore, he mentioned that specimens with a light blue body and yellowish anal fins could be variants of a zeevuursever. Populations in which males have a dark body and a dark anal fin are belonging to Cyanthopharynx foae. Well, this makes it clear how complex the description of this species is. In my opinion, further research is needed to properly identify these cichlids. But what I do know for sure is that I wanted to share these images with you, which have given you a glimpse into the natural habitat of this beautiful cichlid, a cichlid who is also under pressure by the ornamental trade.